All rise, veuve levée. The International Criminal Court is now in session. L'audience de la Cour pénale internationale est ouverte. Please be seated. Veuve vous asseoir.
Good morning. I would like to welcome everybody in the courtroom. Would the court officer please call the case?
Thank you, Mr. President. The situation in the Central African Republic in the case of the prosecutor versus Jean-Pierre Bemba Gombo, Aimé Kilolo Musemba, Jean-Jacques Magenda Kabongo, Fidel Babala Wandu, and Narcisse Arido. Case reference ICC 0105. 0113. We are in open session.
Thank you. Counsel, please introduce yourselves and your clients for the record. Perhaps we start with the prosecution, please.
Mr. Kweku van der Puy, senior trial lawyer. Ms. Olivia Shriven, trial lawyer. Mr. Hesham Murad, trial lawyer. Ms. Ruth Frolic, trial lawyer. Mr. Nema Mileninia, trial lawyer. Ms. Colin Guild, associate trial lawyer. Ms. Sylvie Wakchum, assistant trial lawyer. And Ms. Sylvie Vindinya, case manager. And myself, Fatou Bensouda, prosecutor.
Thank you very much. Counsel, please. We start with the counsel for Mr. Bemba.
Good morning, Mr. President, Your Honours. My name is Melinda Taylor, and I'm appearing this morning on behalf of Mr. Jean-Pierre Bemba, and I'm appearing together with Ms. Natasha Lebandre and Ms. Inez Pierre Delabriere. Thank you.
Thank you, and especially want to thank the defense of Mr. Bemba to facilitate the seating plan today. We want to accommodate everybody, but the impossible we cannot reach, so you helped us with that. Thank you very much insofar. Then we continue with a counsel for Mr. Kilolo.
Bonjour, Monsieur le Président. La défense de Maître Kilolo Musemba est assurée par moi-même, Maître Paul Djunga, avocat au barreau de Paris, avec Maître Stephen Powells, avocat au barreau de Londres, avec l'assistance de Mademoiselle Groga, case manager. Merci.
Thank you. We continue with Mr. Mangenda's counsel.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Good morning to you. Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Christopher Gosnell. I represent Mr. Mangenda in these proceedings this morning. I'm accompanied by Maître Arthur Virquen, by Nikki Sethi, and by Mr. Mangenda himself. Thank you.
Thank you. Counsel for Mr. Babala.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour. Bonjour, Monsieur de la Cour. Je suis Jean-Pierre Kilenda Kakengibasila, avocat au barreau de Bruxelles et de Kinshasa-Gombe. Je suis accompagné de Maître Azama Chali Rodoma, qui est avocat au barreau de Bruxelles, et de Mademoiselle Maria Adriana Manolescu, qui est notre gestionnaire de dossier. Nous assistons bien sûr Monsieur Fidel Babala Wandu, qui est assis à ma droite. Je vous remercie.
Thank you. Finally, counsel for Mr. Arido.
Bonjour, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour, Monsieur les juges. Mon nom est Philippe Larochelle, du barreau du Québec. Je suis accompagné de Monsieur Arido et de Monsieur Michael Rose, et à l'extrême droite, de Monsieur Tibor Bainovitch. Bonne journée.
Thank you very much. For the members of the public and also for the parties and participants, since not everybody may know us yet, meaning the bench, my name is Bertram Schmidt. I'm the presiding judge of this trial chamber. On my right is Judge Marc Perrin de Prichambeau, and on my left, Judge Raoul Pangalangan. As you are aware and you have heard from the court officer, we are here today for the opening of the trial of Mr. Jean-Pierre Bemba Gombo, Mr. Aimé Kilolo Muzamba, Mr. Jean-Jacques Mangenda Kabongo, Mr. Fidel Babala, and Mr. Narcisse Arido. Today, before the charges are read to the accused, the chamber will provide further guidance as to the proper conduct of the proceedings, and we will render a couple of oral decisions on requests still pending that you probably were awaiting or are awaiting. Finally, we will hear the opening statement of the prosecution. Later in the trial, when it is time for the presentation of any defense evidence to begin, the defense will be given an opportunity to make its own opening statements. First, as I have said, some preliminary remarks on the conduct of the present proceedings. First item, so to speak, is the no re-litigation of the main case, which is very important for this case, for the further proceedings to clarify. The chamber emphasizes again that the purpose of these proceedings is not to relitigate the main case, namely the case of the prosecutor versus Jean-Pierre Bemba Gombo. Submissions which attempt to do so, or evidence presented solely for these purposes, will not be entertained. This has been said before, but the chamber wishes to take a moment to explain what it means when it says that the main case is not to be relitigated. The pretrial chamber in this case explained explicitly that it was, and I quote, obviously not in a position to assess the reliability and truthfulness of the witness's testimony on issues pertaining to the merits of the main case, end of quote. This assessment of the pretrial chamber has not changed. This chamber is similarly incapable of making such assessments. The evidence on the merits of the main case was presented before trial chamber 3, not before this chamber. Main case witnesses may have falsely testified on issues pertaining to the merits of the main case, including, for example, whether they were members of certain groups or entities, the structure of these groups or entities, their movements on the ground, and the names of officials. However, this chamber cannot assess the truth or falsity of these statements without command over the evidence in the main case, which would necessitate a partial rehearing of the evidence before this chamber. The result of such a course would be to litigate an Article 70 case and relitigate part of an Article 5 case before another chamber in the course of this hearing. The chamber considers this result to be untenable. There is a division of responsibilities between chambers, meaning that trial chamber 3 and not this chamber is the judicial entity responsible for the findings in the main case. That said, and in these particular circumstances, the chamber finds that it is not necessary to extend its inquiry as to whether or not the witnesses testified falsely to the merits of the main case. Rather, whether or not the witness falsely testified can be ascertained in relation to other information given. Moreover, broadening the scope of this trial to such a degree would dramatically compromise the expeditiousness of proceedings and the right of the accused to be tried without undue delay. It is also to be noted that this case could have been joined to the main case under Rule 165, paragraph 4 of the rules to resolve all case overlap issues, but no such joinder has been made or even been attempted. So, when the Chamber says that this case is not about relitigating the main case, what this means is that this case is about alleged false testimony of witnesses in respect of issues like, first, their previous contacts with the defense, including those where witnesses were coached before testifying, their meetings with other prospective witnesses, their acquaintance with some of the accused or other persons associated with them, the fact that promises had been made to them in exchange for their testimony, and the fact that they had received reimbursements or transferred by Mr. Bemba on his behalf for the purpose of unduly influencing the witness. Statements pertaining to the merits of the main case could perhaps have some relevance in some contexts, such as to show if alleged pre-testimony witness coaching was in fact repeated during testimony. However, these statements will not be considered for their truth or falsity, and evidence submitted solely for the purpose of proving the truth or falsity of such statements at trial will not be considered by the Chamber in its judgment. The main case, to make it clear, and this case are conducted independently. They are on independent tracks, so to speak, looking at evidence for different purposes. I conclude this item and continue with the next one, what is some remarks on the conduct of proceedings. I want to direct your attention now to the conduct of proceedings. First of all, proceedings will be conducted with full respect for the rights of the defense. The accused are presumed innocent until proven guilty, pursuant to Article 66, paragraph 1 of the statute. The burden of proof lies upon the prosecutor. It is her obligation to prove the charges beyond reasonable doubt, and the defense has the last word. Second, the trial will be conducted in an expeditious manner. Proceedings against the five accused were initiated in November 2013, almost 2 years ago. The accused are entitled to a final determination of this court. Four accused are provisionally released and are active in their private and professional lives. They have legitimate expectations to spend a limited amount of time away from their families and other commitments. Mr. Bemba is entitled to know whether he must spend further time in detention. Third, on 2nd September 2015, directions on the conduct of proceedings were given to the parties. This decision regulated certain aspects of the conduct of the proceedings, but also, as you may have noticed, intentionally left certain matters unaddressed, which would be subject to oral determinations in the course of the trial. The reason for this is the following. A trial hearing is a dynamic process which evolves constantly. If it was not so, we could limit ourselves to written procedure. The conduct of proceedings has to be adjusted as need be during the course of the hearing, particularly in accordance with Article 64, paragraph 8b, which describes the powers of the presiding judge. This has to be done in accordance with the legal provisions given to us, namely the Rome Statute, the rules of procedure and evidence, and the regulations of the court. And if need be, it has to be done immediately and not following a previously composed script. The Chamber is of the opinion that trying to regulate in detail the conduct of proceedings beforehand, and thus putting the parties and also the judges in a sort of procedural corset, is at least futile. As you have noted, in particular, any items relating to the modalities of questioning were excluded from this ruling. I wish to make clear at the outset that the Chamber has not set strict regulations on questioning so that appropriate limitations can be set on a case-by-case basis. Despite this, I want to point out that any unfocused questioning of witnesses will not be allowed. Repetitious questions should be avoided. This rule, so to speak, does not only apply to any single party. It also applies to the defense as a whole, meaning that questions should not be repeated by different defense teams. If parties object to the way that any particular question is raised, such objections must be clear, short, and concise. Moreover, and I go further to another point, the Chamber wants to uphold the principle of orality. This principle is a precondition of a fair trial, and it guarantees that the trial is not a succession of written submissions and decisions. It means that the arguments of the parties are discussed in the courtroom. It requires that the parties make requests orally and are prepared to address emergent issues and questions orally, and if need be, spontaneously in the courtroom. The Chamber ascribes to counsel the professional skills that enable them to discuss matters promptly, or at least after a short break for consideration. The Chamber will not grant lengthy interruptions whenever a contentious issue arises. Furthermore, the Chamber expects that the parties are prepared at all times. If the time allotted to any one party is not fully used, the bench will automatically move to the next item on the schedule, and the schedule will be adjusted should circumstances so require. In particular, parties must always be prepared to continue with the case, even if less time than estimated is required for a particular witness. Finally, for these preliminary remarks, parties are generally expected to be precise, concise, and to the point. Repetitious arguments, as well as I have said, repetitious questions should be avoided. The defense of each accused, while having the right to advance relevant arguments at any time, should use its time wisely. Submissions by one defense team need not be reiterated by another. Everything what has to be said can be said, but not by everybody. In line with the aforementioned, meaning upholding the principle of orality, the Chamber may also issue certain decisions orally as the trial unfolds in order to keep the proceedings moving at an appropriate pace. And as I said, in line with that, the Chamber will now render several such decisions. First, on the prosecution application for leave to appeal, the decision on prosecution application to provide notice pursuant to Regulation 55, that is filing 1270 in the record, submitted on 18th September 2015. The impugned decision is filing 1250 in the record and was filed on 15th September 2015. In this request, the prosecution seeks leave to appeal on, I quote, whether the trial chamber erred by taking into consideration an irrelevant factor, namely that the prosecution did not seek leave to appeal the confirmation decision, or request to amend the charges according to Article 61, paragraph 9 of the Rome Statute. Quote end. The Arrido defense has requested the chamber to reject this issue in filing 1298. The chamber recalls the leave to appeal test as set out in its previous decisions, in particular the requirement that an appealable issue is constituted by a subject the resolution of which is essential for the determination of matters arising in the judicial course under examination. In addition to the consideration referenced by the prosecution, the Chamber's reasoning in the impugned decision was independently premised on the fact that the proposed recharacterizations were rejected by the pretrial chamber and that no exceptional circumstances or, quote, any other reasons were apparent to the Chamber which justified granting Regulation 55, paragraph 2, notice. As such, even if the prosecution were to prevail on its appeal, the Chamber's ultimate decision would remain the same. The prosecution's issue is therefore not essential for the determination of the impugned decision, and leave to appeal is rejected. Second, the Chamber will now render a decision on the application by Mr. Kilolo for leave to appeal the, I quote, decision on Kilolo defense motion for inadmissibility of material, that is filing 1274 in the record, submitted on 21st September 2015. The impugned decision is filing 1257 in the record and was filed on 16th September 2015. In this application, the defense for Mr. Kilolo seeks leave to appeal when, how, and under what circumstances, and with what protections, interference with privileged communications may be exercised. The application is contested by the prosecution. The Chamber has previously noted that an appealable issue under Article 82, paragraph 1d of the statute requires the parties to articulate discrete issues, and it is insufficient to argue that the Chamber has generally erred in its findings. By asserting that the Chamber did not sufficiently uphold the protection enshrined in Article 67, paragraph 1b of the statute, the defense is doing little more than challenging the entirety of the Chamber's decision. The application fails to disclose any discrete appealable issue arising from the decision, and the Chamber thus rejects the application for leave to appeal. Third, the Chamber will also now render a decision on, I quote, prosecution's application for leave to appeal, the decision on witness preparation and familiarization, filing 1276 in the record, submitted on 21st September 2015. The impugned decision is filing 1252 in the record and was filed on 15th September 2015. In this application, the prosecution seeks leave to appeal three issues, namely, whether the trial chamber erred in failing to provide a reasoned opinion, whether the trial chamber erred in balancing the potential risks of witness preparation vis-à-vis the party's right to prepare their cases, and whether the trial chamber erred by failing to take into account or accord proper weight to relevant factors. The Chamber considers that the first issue does not arise from the appeal. Furthermore, the prosecution in the three issues it has listed for certification has failed to substantiate specific detriments or harms that will accrue to the prosecution in the current case as a result of the Chamber's decision to disallow witness preparation. To this extent, the resolution of the issues highlighted by the prosecution would not significantly affect the fair and expeditious conduct of proceedings or the outcome of the trial within the meaning of Article 82, paragraph 1d of the statute. Leave to appeal is therefore rejected. This concludes the oral decisions by the Chamber, but allow me an additional remark on leave to appeal requests that is directed to all of the parties here in the room. Irrespective of these decisions on important procedural issues dealing with interlocutory appeals, allow me this general remark on requests for leave to appeal, which constantly and, so to speak, incessantly flow into the case record. While the Chamber is mindful of the rights of the parties to seek legal remedy under Article 82, paragraph 1d of the statute, I would like to remind that such interlocutory appeals are exceptional, and they are not or should not be an automatic reflex as it sometimes appears. They are neither meant to be a hidden application for reconsideration nor a legal tool to express mere disagreement with any of the Chamber's decisions. And we all know that it lies in the nature of things that usually at least one party is not completely satisfied with what the Chamber decides. Furthermore, even if we talk about potentially reversible error, this may be particular at the stage of proceedings that we have now reached, better and justly deferred to any final appeal under Article 81. Last point, to admissibility of evidence, few remarks. The Chamber also recalls its approach to relevance and admissibility of evidence set out in its decision of 24th of September 2015. In this decision, the Chamber determined that, as a general rule, these proceedings would be conducted more efficiently if the Chamber defers its assessment of the admissibility of evidence to the judgment pursuant to Article 74, paragraph 2 of the statute. With this in mind, whenever one of the parties wishes to submit an item for the Chamber to consider in its judgment, it may request that a particular piece of material be formally submitted. The other parties may then raise any issue relating to relevance or admissibility pursuant to Rule 64 of the rules. The Chamber will then recognize the item as submitted, at which point the registry will reflect in the e-court metadata that the item has been formally submitted. We conclude now the preliminary remarks and continue with the issues that have been raised, the objections that have been raised in the course of the proceedings. The Chamber invited the parties to raise any issue which requires a resolution prior to the commencement of the trial. The Chamber received 13 requests on 10th of August 2015 and has subsequently ruled on all of them. However, and noting Rule 134, paragraph 2 of the rules, the Chamber will now ask the parties whether they have any remaining objections or observations concerning the conduct of proceedings which have arisen since the confirmation hearings. We would like to start with the prosecution.
None, Mr. President.
Then we continue with the defense. Perhaps we stay with the sequence we started with, the defense for Mr. Bemba.
Thank you, Mr. President. Your Honors, no. For the record, no, we don't at this point.
Then the defense for Mr. Kilolo.
Pas d'observation particulière, Monsieur le Président.
Linda?
No, not at this time, okay. Mr. President. Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Understand.
Nous n'avons aucune observation, Monsieur le Président.
And finally, the defense for Mr. Arrido.
Nous avons des observations, Monsieur le Président. Nous attendons encore du matériel du procureur. Le procureur a reçu un ordre de votre part de nous donner du matériel, les RFA. Nous n'avons pas encore reçu cela. Je manifeste poliment mon désaccord avec la décision que vous avez rendue très récemment et pour laquelle nous avons encore un délai pour déposer un appel qui, je l'espère, ne recevra pas le même sort que ceux sur lesquels vous avez rendu des décisions ce matin. Donc, nous avons au moins ces deux points-là. S'ensuit évidemment les conséquences de l'ordre des témoins pour lequel nous avons déposé nos observations. Je ne vais pas tout répéter ici. Donc, je suis pris un peu à brûle pour point. Je suis sûr que je peux trouver d'autres problèmes qui, à notre sens, ne sont pas encore totalement résolus. Nous entendons aussi déposer une demande d'appel, une autre, sur la décision que vous avez rendue concernant, veuillez excuser l'anglicisme, les bar table motions. Donc, une grande quantité de preuves flotte dans les airs sans que l'on sache trop quel traitement elle va recevoir. Donc, nous expliquons dans cet appel que nous allons déposer incessamment en quoi nous sommes en désaccord, encore une fois, je l'exprime poliment, avec l'approche retenue par la Chambre quant au traitement de cette preuve. C'est ce qui me vient à l'esprit pour l'instant. Si vous voulez, je peux peut-être réviser toutes mes notes pour demain matin, et si je trouve autre chose, vous en faire part également avant que nous reprenions l'audience demain matin.
Thank you. The Chamber has taken note of your positions. If necessary, of course, we will decide on your objections later during the trial. In accordance with Article 64, paragraph 8A of the Rome Statute, the charges will now be read to the five accused, following which each will be invited to enter his plea. Court officer, please read the operative part of the decision on the confirmation of charges. Since all accused are French-speaking, please read the French version.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Jean-Pierre Bemba, pardon, a, au sens de l'article 70.1c, et de l'article 25.3a, coaction du statut, commis avec Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Jacques Magenda l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en planifiant et coordonnant avec les autres suspects la commission de cette infraction. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Autre qualification possible. Jean-Pierre Bemba a, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3b du statut, sollicité la commission de l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en dirigeant et coordonnant avec les autres suspects la commission de cette infraction. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Jean-Pierre Bemba a, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3a, coaction du statut, commis avec Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Jacques Magenda l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve faux s'agissant des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en planifiant et coordonnant avec les autres suspects la commission de cette infraction. Infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Autre qualification possible. Jean-Pierre Bemba a, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3b du statut, sollicité la commission de l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve faux s'agissant des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en dirigeant et coordonnant avec les autres suspects la commission de cette infraction. Infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Jean-Pierre Bemba a, au sens de l'article 70.1a et de l'article 25.3b du statut, sollicité la commission par les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 de l'infraction de faux témoignage d'une personne qui a pris l'engagement de dire la vérité en application de l'article 69, paragraphe 1 du statut, en dirigeant et coordonnant avec les autres suspects la commission de cette infraction. Infraction couverte par les chefs 1, 4, 7, 10, 13, 16, 19, 22, 25, 28, 31, 34, 37 et 40 du document de notification des charges. Aimé Kilolo, a au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3a, coaction, du statut, commis avec Jean-Pierre Bemba et Jean-Jacques Magenda, l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64, en leur donnant pour instruction, en personne ou par téléphone, de livrer de fausses informations ou de taire des informations véridiques pendant leur témoignage à l'audience et en promouvant ou encourageant ou récompensant leur témoignage par des transferts d'argent. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Aimé Kilolo a, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3a, coaction du statut, commis avec Jean-Pierre Bemba et Jean-Jacques Magenda, l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve oraux faux en connaissance de cause, en faisant comparaître les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 dans le cadre des audiences devant la Chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Aimé Kilolo a, au sens de l'article 70.1a et de l'article 25.3b du statut, solliciter ou encourager la commission par les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 de l'infraction de faux témoignage d'une personne qui a pris l'engagement de dire la vérité en application de l'article 69, paragraphe 1 du statut, en les amenant par des instructions, la persuasion ou toute autre forme d'influence, y compris au moyen de transfert d'argent, à livrer de fausses informations ou à taire des informations véridiques devant la Chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 1, 4, 7, 10, 13, 16, 19, 22, 25, 28, 31, 34, 37 et 40 du document de notification des charges. Jean-Jacques Magenda a, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3a, coaction, du statut, commis avec Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo, l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64, en assurant la liaison entre Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo, ainsi qu'en discutant avec Aimé Kilolo des transferts d'argent à ses témoins et du contenu de leurs témoignages, en coordonnant avec lui leurs actions en ce sens et en le conseillant à ce propos, en procurant aux témoins des téléphones portables et en participant activement à des réunions au cours desquelles les témoins étaient préparés de manière illicite. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Autre qualification possible, Jean-Jacques Magenda A, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3c du statut, a porté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo de l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64, en assurant la liaison entre Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo, ainsi qu'en discutant avec Aimé Kilolo des transferts d'argent à ses témoins et du contenu de leurs témoignages, en coordonnant avec lui leurs actions en ce sens et en le conseillant à ce propos, en procurant aux témoins des téléphones portables et en participant activement à des réunions au cours desquelles les témoins étaient préparés de manière illicite. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Jean-Jacques Magenda A, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3a, coaction du statut, commis avec Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve oraux faux en connaissance de cause, en faisant comparaître les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 dans le cadre des audiences devant la chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Autre qualification possible, Jean-Jacques Magenda A, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3c du statut, a porté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par Jean-Pierre Bemba et Aimé Kilolo de l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve oraux faux en faisant comparaître les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 dans le cadre des audiences devant la chambre de première instance 3, en aidant en sa qualité de chargé de la gestion des dossiers le conseil principal à introduire des faux témoignages dans l'affaire principale, en discutant régulièrement avec Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Pierre Bemba, les conseillant et leur rendant compte au sujet des faux témoignages livrés par D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 devant la chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Jean-Jacques Magenda a, au sens de l'article 70.1a et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 de l'infraction de faux témoignage d'une personne qui a pris l'engagement de dire la vérité en application de l'article 69, paragraphe 1 du statut, en participant activement à des réunions où les témoins étaient préparés de manière illicite, en procurant aux témoins des téléphones portables et en discutant régulièrement avec Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Pierre Bemba, les conseillant et leur rendant compte au sujet des faux témoignages livrés par les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 devant la chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 1, 4, 7, 10, 13, 16, 19, 22, 25, 28, 31, 34, 37 et 40 du document de notification des charges. Fidel Babala a, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporter son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par Jean-Pierre Bemba, Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Jacques Magenda de l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en gérant et distribuant à cet effet, selon que de besoin et de manière appropriée, les fonds à disposition de Jean-Pierre Bemba. Infraction couverte par les chefs 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, 30, 33, 36, 39 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Fidel Babala a, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par Jean-Pierre Bemba, Aimé Kilolo et Jean-Jacques Magenda de l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve faux par l'entremise des témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 en gérant et distribuant à cet effet, selon que de besoin et de manière appropriée, les fonds à disposition de Jean-Pierre Bemba, infraction couverte par les chefs 2, 5, 8, 11, 14, 17, 20, 23, 26, 29, 32, 35, 38 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Fidel Babala a, au sens de l'article 70.1a et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporter son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par les témoins D2, D3, D4, D6, D13, D15, D23, D25, D26, D29, D54, D55, D57 et D64 de l'infraction de faux témoignage d'une personne qui a pris l'engagement de dire la vérité en application de l'article 69, paragraphe 1 du statut. En gérant et distribuant à cet effet, selon que de besoin et de manière appropriée, les fonds à disposition de Jean-Pierre Bemba, infraction couverte par les chefs 1, 4, 7, 10, 13, 16, 19, 22, 25, 28, 31, 34, 37 et 40 du document de notification des charges. Narcisse Arido a, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3a, commission du statut, commis l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 en leur donnant pour instruction de livrer de fausses informations ou de taire des informations véridiques pendant leur comparution devant la Cour et en encourageant leur témoignage par des transferts d'argent et la possibilité d'une réinstallation en Europe. Infraction couverte par les chefs 12, 15, 18 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Autre qualification possible. Narcisse Arido a, au sens de l'article 70.1c et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission de l'infraction de subornation des témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 en leur donnant pour instruction de livrer un faux témoignage et en encourageant leur témoignage par des transferts d'argent et la possibilité d'une réinstallation en Europe. Infraction couverte par les chefs 12, 15, 18 et 42 du document de notification des charges. Narcisse Arido a, au sens de l'article 70.1b et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporté son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par Jean-Pierre Bemba, Aimé Kilolo, et Jean-Jacques Magenda de l'infraction de production d'éléments de preuve oraux faux en faisant comparaître les témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 dans le cadre des audiences devant la chambre de première instance 3, en donnant des instructions aux témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 sur les fausses informations à livrer à la Cour et en les présentant à Aimé Kilolo, infraction couverte par les chefs 11, 14, 17 et 41 du document de notification des charges. Narcisse Arido a, au sens de l'article 70.1a et de l'article 25.3c du statut, apporter son aide, son concours ou toute autre forme d'assistance en vue de faciliter la commission par les témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 de l'infraction de faux témoignage d'une personne qui a pris l'engagement de dire la vérité en application de l'article 69, paragraphe 1 du statut, en recrutant les témoins D2, D3, D4 et D6 en les amenant par des instructions, la persuasion ou toute autre forme d'influence, y compris au moyen de transfert d'argent et de la possibilité d'une réinstallation en Europe, à livrer de fausses informations ou à taire des informations véridiques devant la chambre de première instance 3. Infraction couverte par les chefs 10, 13, 16 et 40 du document de notification des charges.
Thank you, court officer. Now, according to Article 64, paragraph 8A, each accused will be afforded the opportunity to make an admission of guilt or to plead not guilty. Mrs. Taylor, could you please confirm that you have explained the nature of the charges to Mr. Bemba and his right to plead either guilty or not guilty to the charges?
Thank you, Mr. President. Yes, I have.
Thank you. Mr. Junger, could you please confirm that you have explained the nature of the charges to Mr. Kilolo and his right to plead either guilty or not guilty to the charges?
Merci, Monsieur le Président. C'est effectivement fait. Et c'était d'autant plus facile que Maître Aimé Kilolo lui-même est conseil et il comprend très bien.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Mr. Gosnell, can you please confirm that you have explained the nature of the charges to Mr. Mangenda and his right to plead either guilty or not guilty to the charges?
Mr. President, I can and do confirm that.
Thank you. Mr. Kilenda, can you please confirm that you have explained the nature of the charges to Mr. Babala and his right to plead either guilty or not guilty to the charges?
Monsieur le Président, dès sa comparution à l'audience de première comparution, Monsieur Babal a avoué ne pas comprendre cette affaire parce qu'il ne comprenait pas pourquoi il était ici. Au fur et à mesure, et jusqu'à ce jour, nous lui avons expliqué ce dont il s'agissait. Il sait de quoi il s'agit, il vous le dira tout à l'heure.
Mr. La Rochelle, can you please confirm that you have explained the nature of the charges to Mr. Arido and his right to plead either guilty or not guilty to the charges?
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bien qu'elles sont d'une lecture plutôt ardue, nous avons effectivement expliqué à Monsieur Arido la nature des charges auxquelles il faisait face et il nous a confirmé qu'il plaidait non coupable. Merci.
Thank you. Mr. Bemba, please rise.
Oui, Monsieur le Président.
Do you understand the nature of the charges read out to you today? Do you plead guilty with respect to any charge? First question, do you understand the nature of the charges read out to you today?
J'ai bien compris la nature des charges, Monsieur le Président, et bien entendu, je peux vous dire que je plaide non coupable. Sur toutes les charges qui ont été lues ici.
Yeah. This would have been the question that I have added to all the charges. Please be seated. Then, Mr. Kilolo, please rise. Do you understand the same questions, of course? Do you understand the nature of the charges read out to you today?
Tout à fait, je le confirme. Mm-hmm.
Do you plead guilty with respect to any of the charges?
Monsieur le Président, je plaide non coupable à l'égard de chacune des charges alléguées.
Yeah, thank you. Please be seated. Mr. Mangenda, please rise. Do you understand the charges, the nature of the charges read out to you today?
Oui, Monsieur le Président, je comprends la nature de toutes les charges.
Do you plead guilty with respect to any charge?
Je plaide non coupable à l'égard de toutes les charges.
Mr. Babala, please rise. Please rise, Mr. Babala. Do you understand the nature of the charges read out to you today?
Oui, Monsieur le Président, je les comprends toutes.
Yeah. Do you plead guilty with respect to any charge?
Je plaide effectivement non coupable. en ce qui concerne toutes les charges qui ont été présentées dans l'accusation. Je vous remercie.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Arido, please rise. Do you understand the nature of the charges read out to you today?
C'est compliqué, Monsieur le Président, mais j'avoue que je comprends, mais c'est quand même compliqué. Je comprends. Et je plaide non coupable. Mm-hmm.
Not guilty with respect to all the charges?
Tout à fait, Monsieur le Président. Dès le début, j'ai toujours plaidé non coupable.
Thank you. Please be seated.